Craig Hammack.
Shannon Justison.
Janelle Croshaw Ralla.
Nick Crew.
Kevin Souls.
Are the five of you ever normally in the same room together?
No.
Never.
Maybe the VES awards.
Yeah.
So when you go out for awards, that's the only time you see each other?
Yeah.
Are you in the same building even?
No.
Not
same
even in the
continent, maybe?
Yeah.
Not the same city, you know?
Yeah. So you're all in different cities even? Is that?
No, Shannon and I will, we work in-house at Marvel.
Uh-huh.
I was the additional visual effects supervisor on Captain Marvel under Christopher Townsend. And she's the pre-visualization supervisor. And so we're in-house. And then the others, we usually only see on set, you know, here and there, and then over CineSync and video conferencing.
So that's really how you know you guys are?
We're video conference buddies.
Yeah.
Post-Skype.
Yeah.
You've evolved past Skype
to
another level. Does that stuff work for you guys the way it doesn't work for anybody else?
It works well. I mean, I think it's been such a part of our industry for so long now that we've just adapted to it. Like you know to wait a second before you step on someone else's,
right.
If there's a lag in the conversation, you know.
Yeah. Still awkward, but you're used to it.
You get used to it.
It works well. At Marvel, we have a great setup. So for Luma, for instance, Kevin would be on, you know, down in Santa Monica. I'm up here, and then his partner is in Melbourne.
Yep.
And so we're using a program called CineSync, where we're looking at the same images. We can draw on the images, but then we also have cameras set up, you know, so we have another monitor where we see each other, and it works really well. Mm.
So is there a hierarchy within the group, or is each person in a different area, essentially?
Well, I'm the additional visual effects supervisor at Marvel.
Yes.
And so, and then, you know, she's also at Marvel.
But yes, well, sort of. The rest of us are all vendor soups, so.
Exactly.
Right.
She's on client side, we're vendors. So Janelle, and then who's not here is Christopher Townsend, who was the visual effects supervisor. They're the ones who hire all of us.
Right.
And then we each have our own teams that we run for our respective studios. And whether it's me who's actually in-house with Marvel, or whether it's these guys who are with their teams wherever they are in the world, we're all supervising our own groups.
Right. And do you consider your client as director or Marvel?
Well, I work for Christopher Townsend.
Right.
And then, you know,
so Christopher's your client.
He is, you know, but then at the same time, we're working directly in-house with the studio execs, and especially the directors and the editors.
I think we have multiple masters
in
a lot of ways. Yeah. I think that there's the studio needs, there's the director needs, and then there's the supervisor needs. And as a vendor, you kind of have to balance all three of them, and hopefully they all align. Sometimes they don't, and you have to kind of help solve those issues.
And our notes are very, you know, we're constantly doing reviews with the directors, studio execs, and editors, you know, all together. And we're also giving notes as the visual effects supervisors to the vendors, and they're very agnostic notes. It's never, or rarely, this came from the director. You know, it's just as a collective whole, here's the notes, you know, on the shots.
So as the pieces come together, it's a thing, and I guess in animation, they always say that they don't really have any idea what they have until, you know, 2 months before the movie's coming out, generally, because it's like each piece is coming in. Is it that way in effects also with you guys?
It's even less in visual effects, I think.
Yeah.
It's a shorter window.
I think that everyone starts with a general idea of what it's going to be. We start with storyboards, and then that moves into Previs. And then it goes into photography, and photography then changes what it's going to be. Then you go into post, and then post, it evolves, and sometimes you go all the way back to storyboards when you're in post, and then redo different sections. It's a constantly evolving beast.
Yeah.
And I always say it's something easy. There's nothing easy, I guess, in the world. But do things get easier, and then you move on to the next thing? Or is it just that everything is always making each thing that maybe has been done before a better thing? Or is it just a constant level of improvement on what you've done in the past? Or is it really?
It's always, you know, it depends on what the needed effect is for the particular scene. And what's great about Shannon and her team is they lay the groundwork with previs, and then what's called post-vis, which is using the photography. And, you know, say it's a blue screen that was shot, they'll fill the blue screen and give a really good template for the vendors. And I think as far as adding to, I mean, Craig could probably speak to that for ILM, like if it's characters from the past, I mean, you know, especially Marvel characters, they're constantly improving on those, you know, as you move forward, but a lot of effects are unique.
It is kind of amazing watching the first Avengers and then watching Endgame.
Yeah.
Not that you guys did Endgame, but, you know, that step is always kind of shocking, actually.
Yeah.
Because you thought it was perfect the first time, because it was then, and then 10 years later it's old.
But audiences' eyes are also evolving, and they want to see better. You know, and so you're having to stay up with them and continue to evolve.
Yeah, it is surprising, though, even like as a vendor, when you were contacted by Marvel or whoever, it's surprising where the choices are made, you know, because at the end of the day, there's still a fixed, you know, bucket of money to spend, and upgrading everything is expensive. Right, so you have to be responsible about what you know, you can pull from the past, what needs to be upgraded, and it's always surprising, like how much stock they put into just moving things to the next level, mm-hmm. right? Whereas you know, Iron Man doesn't always need a new suit, but he always gets a new suit,
right.
You know, and it's that kind of thing that. You know, they know their audience really well, and
so
they know
what. So, if he gets a new suit, does it always have to be a more complicated suit?
It does.
That's part of it.
That's part of it. Yeah.
So, what was the biggest? Was there a biggest challenge on Captain Marvel?
I mean, I think the biggest challenges were the de-aging, the CG cat goose, the binary effect, and then you know each individual vendor had their own specific. You know, challenges, Luma with the train sequence, and I know yours was probably the crash, and the, you know, when Captain Marvel gained her powers,
yes.
You know, and then Previs is just their challenge the entire time, because they have to come up with what everything looks like, you know.
So did one of you do Goose, or is Goose on any particular plate here, or?
Well, Goose was, Goose was originally done by Trickster, the asset, and then ILM took over Goose and made the
Flurkin. Yeah, so Trickster, a company that's not represented here, did the initial asset and did the match to the real Goose, and it was spotless, you know. We were approached to do the part of the shots where the Flurkin actually comes out and the alien part of it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we took their initial thing and had to match it, and then... you know, built the tentacled alien Flurkin funny model to come out of its mouth. And you know, that harkens back to a lot of the comic book stuff and stuff that Third Floor did, you know, to kind of bring that to life and with the directors in motion. And then we just basically take over and do the fleshing out of it.
So with you guys being professionals and... You know, you do your job, whatever that job ends up coming to you that you're going to do. But does, when something like the Flurkin comes up, are you like, ooh, that's going to be the greatest moment? You know, that's going to get a huge audience response, so it's even cooler doing it?
Yeah, or of course. Yeah. I mean, you can tell. Usually, these days, certainly, the previs is good enough. You know exactly what the story point is supposed to come through as. And for the Flurkin, particularly, you know, the previs is funny. You know, it's just built in funny. So you get a little more excitement, and you know that it's something that's going to be referenced and, you know, it's going to be a little campy, a little, you know, but something memorable for people. And you get, you know, you get a little bit more excited, and it's not that it takes on more importance. It's just, it's a morale boost, you know, knowing that it's going to be appreciated like that.
Yeah, there's definitely something fun to working on. We'll be working on these, be like, this is going to be a meme while we're on it. And then, you know, and then then you just have to do the work of like window comps. I mean, there's with the, you know, really fun character moments, and there's a whole bunch of just straight ahead, all the invisible VFX work, which it's not fully invisible because we know that Samuel L. Jackson is not 45, but did an amazing job
making you look
45. Yeah. He looks great for his age. It's really impressive, actually. But yeah, it's the invisible effects in some ways, even though I don't do them, I always think it's incredible when we can't tell anymore, that those effects are there, even though we know they're there.
Well, there was another movie with de-aging, which I found it less I found it more recognizable than I did in this movie. I mean, Sam really was a very clean piece of work. Is that is there a point at which that reaches a level where you can kind of make assumptions going into that in the future for the next movie, or will that too continue to improve and improve and improve and improve?
I think with every character, you have to analyze who the actor is, who the character is, and what work needs to happen, and then you have to factor in what the schedule is and what the budget is, and you know that kind of dictates the workflow in a lot of ways. With this particular workflow, we didn't have a long schedule at all, and you know, Sam was in over 500 shots throughout the whole film, and the shooting schedule was also very short, and so we couldn't use a body double or have any extra cameras or anything like that. And so it really, you know, we were very hands-off on set and let Sam do his thing and let the, you know, the directors and the DP do their thing without really getting in their way. And then in post, we worked with a company called Lola, and they're Soup Trent Klaus, and Lola came up with a really amazing development test. It was actually done before the shoot that you know, became our, it really became like our model of what the rest of the film needed to look like. The thing with the original test was it was these, you know, ideal conditions. It was shot on a green screen. Sam was perfectly astute, and he was, you know, had, you know, he was a certain weight, and he was really happy because I'm sure it was AC, and you know what I mean. It was a nice situation. And then you get the plates back, and every single scene, depending on the wardrobe, the lighting, even maybe what he ate. Some scenes they accidentally powdered his nose too much, you know, and so every single scene had its own challenge as to how we were going to make him look that as good as he did in that test, you know, for these scenes. And so, you know, we really ended up, it was a very organic process where we ended up modifying his entire body, his entire face, you know, even sometimes his hair, and his posture, to just make him, you know, make him appear the 25 years younger, but not take away from his character in any way.
Is there a Marvel way at this point? Well, in terms of, I mean, like you, this, the directors on this were new to Marvel. They made a lot of indie films.
In general, with the visual effects? Or
yes, well, this kind of thing of they're shooting the movie, and then there's this effects layer that's, you know, nobody's had experience in unless they've done one of these already. So you often have new filmmakers coming in. Is there a kind of consistent rhythm to how Marvel approaches this versus Steven Spielberg or whoever?
This is my first Marvel film, and I actually found it to be incredibly comforting, the internal pipeline and workflow and structure that they have. And, you know, because you go into it going, how are we going to get 2,000 plus shots done in 6 months? Like, it's impossible. And there's really, I hate to call it a machine because there's so many amazing people involved in it, but it there seems to be a lot of techniques and methodologies that get things done, and a lot of support from Marvel. And then these guys who have done many, many films, I'll let speak more about that.
Yeah, Kevin's probably done the most.
I think, yeah, I've done about six. I think that there is a methodology to it, and they know exactly where to put the effort to get the best possible product out. You know, I think that story drives everything. And they know that it's important to figure out that story early on and to do previs and to get everyone on the same page with what the kind of movie they're trying to make. And that pushes all the way through. And then they also know at the end of the film that these are the changes that need to get made. And this is where we need to spend our time and to have our vendors focus to be able to produce the best possible work. And they're also incredibly good at dividing the work out, casting the right effects houses to do the work, and making sure that they get all the support they need. And honestly, that's one of my favorite companies to work for. It's like very consistent and a great team of people.
So
very creative.
Names, there are people who call up and you're going to do the job, but you're kind of a little less enthusiastic, perhaps, because their method of working is not as clear or clean. Or
well, I mean, put it this way. There's unknowns, right? When I go into a Marvel show, there are knowns. Like, I'm dealing with the same executives who make the same great decisions and have been doing it for years, and I'm dealing with the same producers that have been producing these movies for years, and they know what works. when you're going into a project with people that are less experienced, there's always these unknowns that are sometimes a little scary. Yeah.
So is there ever a, as professionals who do this, is it ever fun or helpful or interesting to have people who are flying by the seat of their pants who haven't had that kind of experience?
Maybe.
Support. You know, it's all about if you're getting the right support. It's fun to do indie films and indie projects, which is kind of my background in a lot of ways. If you have a relationship with the director or executives or producers or whoever it might be on the film, and they actually trust and support you, you know, if you don't, if you're not being given resources that you need to do your job and for your teams to do your job, then it just becomes painful.
Yeah, and I think even in the Marvel structure, you know, there is structure and there is, but I really think of it more of as support. You know, we get our work and we kind of know what we need to do and we can focus in on it. But we still get a large playground to really kind of figure out how we're going to do it, what exactly it's going to look like. So, you know, there are goals for each kind of scope of work. And you know kind of where you need to get to, but the process of getting there and exactly what it's going to look like, we have a lot of creative freedom, yeah. Which is great.
So aside from your individual jobs as vendors on this project on Captain Marvel, is there, when you saw the movie, what effect did you go, that you didn't do, did you go, ooh, that's something special or new or extra cool? Or
I think for me it was the de-aging, yeah. Of Sam Jackson. In particular, because it was in my sequence, the train sequence, and I saw parts of it. And once you watch the movie, you just forget it's happening. And it just becomes, that's what he is, that's what he looks like. It doesn't jar, and it becomes totally normal. And I found that after I walked into the movie, really thinking about it, going like, you know what, that was a fantastic effect. Like, I didn't give it any thought. It didn't bother me, and it looked great.
Yeah, I agree. There are certain effects that, you know, as a person who's been in the industry a while, you see the pain behind it. It, for whatever reason, this felt effortless, and that's, I mean, I know it wasn't,
right?
but it was done so well that, you know, it was remarkable, you know, how flawless it seemed. And still, yeah, and the problem is that it's Sam Jackson, and everyone knows, right. Sam Jackson, and everyone expects a certain performance, and you know they were able to retain all of it.
Mm. You know. And have the tools changed dramatically? Again, like for when they were started doing motion capture, I guess it was down in New Zealand and saw the stage, how they were setting it up, and before they did the dots, and then they were able to do things without the dots, and some things have the dots, and some things don't have the dots. Is that true with de-aging as well, or is that? Is there a technical evolution, or is it just the individual artists doing the work day by day by day by day?
I think each company has their own approach, and so on a lot of films, even this year, there's very different approaches to all the different de-aging that's out there. And mm-hmm. in our particular case, the difference was that we couldn't have body doubles this time. We actually had less resources than we've had in the past, and much more scope, you know, because it was so many shots. And so for certain companies like Lola, they're, you know, secret sauce. It's those artists who have been doing it for over a decade. And mm-hmm. they're just really good and skilled at what they do. The other two vendors, Rising Sun Pictures and Screen Scene, have more of a procedural nuke workflow. And so, you know, all three vendors had different pipelines. But our end result always had to be the same. And so they more or less had freedom to use the tools that they wanted. And in the package called Nuke, you know, that compositing package has evolved a lot in the last decade. You know, you couldn't have done the warping and even paint work that needs to be done to do this sort of effect on a version from, like, you know, an older version of this package. And so the tools have evolved that make it easier. But it's still, in our particular effect, there wasn't like a new technology that was developed, so to speak.
And they say this with editors, certainly with sound editors, a lot of the times not being noticed is what you're going after. And as you said about this particular effect, that was kind of the magic of it, is it looked effortless. Is that ultimately your goal as effects people, is to do something that feels natural, even if it's completely unnatural? in this world?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, even when I'm not in finals VFX at all, but even when it's something that's obviously an effect, like the Skrull transforming into the Surfer, that's clearly that's not a thing. But it still needs to, you still need to believe it. And like, that's the thing. It's like, do you believe it? Like, does it, you know, you should never get thrown out and go back into your seat, so to speak. You should always be carried along with the story, and you should always feel like it belongs, even though it's not a thing in real life at all. The physics, you know, you're in space. This woman can shoot beams out of her arms. Like, these aren't real things. But as long as you buy it and it feels like it belongs, it's a super gray area that we're aiming at. But you know, viewers know when it's right and when it's not right. And people, it's funny what you can get away with as long as people believe that it's real.
Well, and it's funny too.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
It's funny too, the different movies that have different needs and different levels. Because, I mean, the one thing about Marvel, I will say, is that the stories are always so good that it helps the effects. You know, if there are movies where the story's not as good and you're just staring at effects and you're not concerned with the story, you're just picking it apart, then it, you know, there's a different different burden when there's not as good a story.
Well, I think that's true. I've always said that as a critic, you watch a movie, if you're thinking about how it's being edited while you're watching it the first time, the movie's already lost you, so
right.
Give up.
Right.
Well, you guys have obviously gotten past that level. Thank you very much for your time. Appreciate it.
Thanks a lot.
Had a good bake-off.
See you in a few weeks. Yeah, great. Thanks.
Okay, bye.